Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Why We Hurt, The Natural History of Pain by Frank T. Vertosick, Jr., M.D., narrated by Tom Parks. The names of the patients described in this book have been changed, and their stories altered and partially fictionalized in order to preserve confidentiality. The information contained herein is for educational purposes only, and cannot substitute for the personal advice of a physician or other licensed healthcare providers. Pain as God's megaphone is a terrible instrument. C.S. Lewis, The Problem of Pain. Introduction. The Megaphone of God. To Life, which is the place of pain. Bhagavad Gita, Chapter 8. Why do we experience pain? In the simplest sense, pain protects us from bodily harm. Dangerous things are hurtful things, and pain punishes us if we take excessive risks or push our bodies beyond their physical limits. Fire destroys, fire kills, and so pain teaches us to avoid fire. Without the lessons of pain, our bodies would soon be ravaged by commonplace traumas. Witness the cruel limb deformities seen in numbing diseases such as leprosy and syphilis, and in children with the congenital absence of pain perception. But this mechanistic definition belies the more mysterious nature of human pain, a nature rooted in something deeper than Darwinian survivalism. From what dangers do migraine headaches and menstrual cramps shield us? Why do harmless colds cause us such misery? Why does childbirth, a natural and essential process, hurt so badly? Ancient religious teachings equate pain with life itself. The Hindu scripture quoted earlier from the Bhagavad Gita calls life the place of pain. The word of Buddha's first sacred truth asserts that life and pain are inseparable. Birth is suffering, decay is suffering, death is suffering. In short, the five groups of existence are suffering. These are depressing philosophies, to be sure, but hardly surprising coming from people living prior to the advent of narcotics, anesthesia, and high-speed dental drills. Nevertheless, the Bhagavad Gita and the word of Buddha overstate the problem. Life and pain are far from synonymous. In fact, most living species experience no pain at all, or at least nothing that we would call pain in the human sense. Pain is a teacher, the headmaster of nature's survival school. And like any teacher, it requires pupils with an ability to learn. Pain's punishments serve no purpose in creatures incapable of recalling bad experiences and using them to modify future behavior. Plants don't feel pain because they have no behaviors to modify. Primitive animals such as sponges, worms, and insects don't feel pain because their behaviors are, for the most part, genetically determined. An ant runs from the heat of a flame, but this is instinctive reflex and not learned aversion. A toy robot can be programmed to change direction when it strikes a wall, but this doesn't mean a robot feels pain. Simple animals with limited behavioral repertoires and lifespans numbering in weeks or months entering the world already equipped with the knowledge they need to survive. Pain's negative reinforcement would be wasted on them. Pain only matters to organisms with an advanced talent for learning, remembering, and adapting. Buddha's dogma must therefore be reformulated. Pain isn't synonymous with life, it's synonymous with intelligence. Cognition of pain, like cognition in general, requires sophisticated neurological hardware. In plants and lower animals, the preservation of a species requires little in the way of cognitive skills. How smart does a jellyfish need to be? Survival of these species can be assured through the use of heavy armor, redundant anatomy, large-scale reproduction, and other uncomplicated tricks. Since a tree can't withdraw its leaves from a hungry deer, it makes more leaves than it needs. The deer eats its fill, and the tree survives. No need for pain here. Likewise, insects, earthworms, and other invertebrates often have spare body parts, extra eyes, wings, and legs that enable the animals to function even after massive trauma. No need for pain here either. And lower animals can churn out hundreds, even thousands of progeny at a time, making any one organism expendable. For plants and primitive animal forms, redundancy and fecundity compensate for insensate stupidity. Because they are buffered against the detrimental effects of trauma, these species have no need for complicated brains or the cognition of pain. But with the advent of higher intelligence, an entirely new paradigm of survival emerged, one predicated upon the survival of individuals, not on mass production. As organisms acquired the ability to recall their pasts and use this as a template for their futures, they became more skilled at protecting themselves from injury. They could now learn what feels good and what doesn't, and tailor their behavior accordingly. This enabled them to shed redundant anatomy, becoming more efficient in the process. Why eat to support 200 legs when only 4 will do? The dynamics of reproduction changed as well. Higher species now could be propagated by a few thousand organisms instead of a few quadrillion. Individuals became less dispensable, their defenses more sophisticated, and their awareness of environmental hazards more acute. While the invertebrate body is like a Japanese Zero plane of World War II vintage, cheap and comparatively defenseless, yet able to overwhelm an opponent with sheer numbers, the mammalian body is like the modern F-16 fighter jet. Expensive and inexpendable, the F-16 comes equipped with a dazzling array of warning systems designed to keep each and every plane in the air. In the military vernacular, the F-16 has a high survivability. As the need for individual survivability in the animal world escalated, so did the need for more sophisticated warning systems, including a more profound appreciation of pain. A centipede can lose 10 legs and walk away, oblivious to its own dismemberment. A grasshopper can continue to eat its prey, even as another predator devours its abdomen. But a single broken limb can end a mammal's life in the wild, and each individual could be precious to its species' survival. Possessing few spare animals and even fewer spare body parts, mammals live in terror of the slightest wound. Evolution allowed them to become efficient and subsequently much more vulnerable by increasing their fear of bodily injury. Fewer legs and offspring will suffice only if they are exceedingly well cared for. Homo sapiens, needless to say, tops the list of vulnerable mammals. In one of his more memorable Far Side cartoons, Gary Larson depicts two alligators lounging on a riverbank strewn with shredded clothing. One alligator contentedly picks his teeth and muses, "What type of animals were those? No fur, no tough hide, no sharp claws, no big fangs, nothing, just all soft and pink." Larson makes a good point. Physically, we are wimps. We can't fly, are comparatively weak, possess no talons or other biological weaponry, wear no natural armor, and have little foot speed. Our hearing is poor, and our sense of smell is even worse. Our upright posture frees our hands for useful things, but also makes us easily seen and prone to falling down. In their peak reproductive period, women can produce just a single infant each year, and a decade or longer will pass before that infant achieves any semblance of independence. We are fragile, and yet the planet groans under the weight of our numbers. We thrive because our beefy cerebrums allow us to build devices that make us stronger, fleeter, and fiercer than our natural bodies permit. We represent the end product of an evolutionary trend favoring neurological awareness over brute reproductive force. But while this process made us paragons of braininess, it has also made us the Roderick Usher of the animal world. Usher, protagonist of Edgar Allan Poe's short story The Fall of the House of Usher, suffers from a degenerative disease that makes his senses hyperacute. Even the finest silk clothing grates on his skin like coarse sandpaper. While we can compensate for our physical frailness with technology, we remain frail. Like Usher, our vulnerability allows little tolerance for the discomforts endured by other creatures. If we don't eat for a day, we become ravenous. We feel comfortable only in a narrow temperature range. We layer our bodies with clothing, encase our feet in protective shoes, and spend much of the day sheltered from the elements. We cook and season our food, deodorize our air, and shield our heads and eyes from the sun. And these aren't modern practices. Humankind has been building homes, donning clothes, roasting meat, and otherwise manipulating the environment to suit itself since the dawn of history. We control our environment not just because we can, but because we must out of biological necessity. As the most cognizant of creatures, we are also the most sensitive. Moreover, certain of our physical adaptations, large heads, complex thumbs, upright spines, make us prone to sufferings unique among mammals. Our sensitivity goes far beyond the sensation of bodily injury and discomforts, however. In addition to the physical world inhabited by all living creatures, we alone dwell in a parallel world, an abstract realm of thoughts and emotions. It is a psychic world posing its own dangers and inflicting its own wounds. Psychic pain can be as great, if not greater, than pain caused by corporeal trauma. Our mind-body dualism bestows upon us the dubious honor of knowing pain in two domains of existence, the physical and the mental. The intersection of these domains, the melding of biological pain with psychic pain, results in that singularly human amalgam known as suffering. When a dog breaks a leg, he feels physical pain. But when a man breaks a leg, he will experience both physical and psychic pain. The dog knows only that something is wrong. The man, on the other hand, knows much more. He knows that he may be laid up for weeks, that he might need an operation to repair the damaged bone, that he may never enjoy his favorite sport again, that he may lose his job if he's away from work too long. The terrible pain of a broken leg soon merges with the psychic agonies of anger, frustration, worry, and despair. The dog is in pain, the man suffers. Human beings not only feel pain, they also foresee its consequences, both real and imaginary, a prescience that enhances misery many times over. An elderly woman suffers from a backache not just because it hurts, but because she's afraid it might signify an occult cancer. An executive workaholic frets about his chest pain. Maybe it's just heartburn, but he can't be sure. His worrying soon causes him more torment than his chest. The star running back writhes on the field after a knee injury. Is it just a bad sprain, or has the anterior cruciate ligament and his multi-million-dollar future sustained irreversible damage? Even if our deepest fears prove unfounded, our worrying still worsens the acute and chronic pains of injury and disease. And we usually fear the worst. As an emergency room doctor, I treated a man brought in by ambulance after he allegedly amputated his thumb with a supermarket meat slicer. The victim, pale and sweating, retched uncontrollably at the very thought of his injury. After removing the large towel that he had blindly wrapped around his hand, I found that he had only sliced a callus from the thumb. The digit wasn't even bleeding. The patient immediately perked up and left, relieved but embarrassed. The immense horsepower of the human brain allows us to do much more than simply experience pain. We embellish it, magnify it, wallow in it, allow it to rule our lives. My humiliated patient had been reduced to a trembling, vomiting wreck by an injury that existed only in his imagination. In addition to imaginary pains, our brain also allows us to agonize over other hurts we aren't actually feeling at the moment. Future pain, past pain, the pain of loved ones. Just knowing I have a root canal tomorrow can harm my quality of life today. And I remember my wife's tears as she watched our screaming infant daughter being stuck with a doctor's needle for the first time. We even cringe at the sight of pain in strangers and can be deeply affected by feigned agony on movie screens. Because we can think and show empathy, the scope of our pain extends far beyond the here and now of our own bodies. It becomes hard to escape pain, even for a day. Everyone has pain in the future to anticipate and pain in family and friends to worry over. Even during the harmless act of flipping through television channels late at night, I have stumbled across a documentary of a child tormented with cancer pain or a movie scene depicting gruesome torture and have been disturbed by the video image for days. Such is the nature of human suffering. No wonder Buddha felt suffering to be synonymous with existence. Pain is to suffering what sex is to romance. Products of nerve cells and hormones, pain and sex are simply the physiological substrates for deeper metaphysical phenomena. Suffering, like love, requires a human dimension in addition to the raw biology, a dimension of intellect, imagination, emotions, cultural influences, and spiritual beliefs. Because of its human dimension, the perception of pain varies according to each person's culture, religion, and personal makeup. The modern attitude toward pain differs considerably from that of ancient Spartans. A Navy SEAL's idea of pain differs from my own. Pain perception also depends upon the state of mind. An arm injury incurred while drunk driving hurts more than the same injury sustained during a gold medal performance in the Olympic giant slalom. Standing on the winner's platform, listening to the national anthem, can ease pain. The same can't be said of sitting in a holding cell in some county jail, watching your reputation go down the drain. Pain evolved in concert with animal intelligence, while suffering needed the next step in neurological development, the advent of consciousness. Buddha's first truth can be further refined. Suffering is synonymous with awareness. Of course, Buddhism is not alone in its preoccupation with suffering. Suffering plays a central role in all religions, illustrating our profound obsession with pain and its consequences, both here and in the hereafter. In his book, The Problem of Pain, theologian C.S. Lewis explores the inseparability of religion and pain by analyzing what he believes to be the ultimate paradox in Judeo-Christianity. Why would a benevolent and all-powerful maker create a world so saturated with suffering when he could have made it in any way he desired? Lewis argues that God could never command our attention if we lived in an anesthetic world. Without pain, he reasons, people would be so preoccupied with having a good time that they would not heed their maker nor have any reason to give praise to him. Pain becomes, in the words of Lewis, the divine megaphone through which God speaks to us, calling us to his worship. As anyone who has ever passed a kidney stone well knows, pain does have a way of commanding our attention. Unfortunately, the megaphone theory makes God akin to a firefighter who commits arson just to play hero by later extinguishing the flames, or like a nurse who poisons patients to feel the joy of resuscitating them afterward. If Lewis is correct, God has the power to create a pain-free existence, but will not do so out of fear of being rendered unneeded, ignored, and irrelevant. The portrayal of pain in religious writings is more subtle than Lewis acknowledges. Pain's role in religion reflects its role in life. Pain is biological, but suffering necessarily arises from cognitive awareness. Only after Adam and Eve eat from the tree of knowledge are their eyes open to true suffering. Later, in the New Testament, even Jesus shows a vulnerability to the mental dimension of pain. Although he would die a terrible death on the cross, Christ's greatest suffering took place in the Garden of Gethsemane, where an intense dread of impending torture caused him to sweat blood. An animal can be tortured to death, but only a human being suffers in anticipation of pain. The Bible, like other religious teachings, contains numerous allegories illustrating the mental dimension of pain. To answer Lewis's question, suffering is neither megaphone nor rod of punishment. It is an inevitable consequence of being aware. To be conscious is to suffer, and, in the Christian paradigm, even the Son of God cannot escape this axiom. The idea that suffering exists above and beyond physical pain also underlies the concept of hell. Hell, or something like it, is an integral part of many religions, including Greek and Roman mythologies, Hinduism, and Christianity. Hell doesn't employ physical pain, since in hell the soul must suffer sans body. Early religions had trouble imagining pure metaphysical suffering and portrayed hell as a place of bodily torture. Ancient Hindus, for example, believed that souls retained an earthly substance that could be tortured according to the sin committed. Gluttons to be boiled in oil, offenders of the higher caste to be torn asunder by swines, and so forth. The modern Christian hell, the one I was taught in Catholic school, represents psychic suffering distilled to its most crystalline form, a form that needs no skin to burn, limbs to crush, or bowels to tear away. Hell symbolizes the feeling of loss, the feeling of never seeing God or knowing bliss. Hell is not the pain of a broken neck, but the mourning and despair felt by the quadriplegic long after the neck heals. Dante understood this hell. The portal to his inferno carries the admonition, "Abandon all hope, ye who enter here." It is this distilled suffering, this hell of earth, that I see in my office every day. Pain that patients suffer not just from their peculiar afflictions, but also from abandonment of their hope for future recovery. There is a very good reason for understanding the dual nature of pain. The therapy of chronic pain syndromes may require treatment aimed independently at both the mental and physical aspects of suffering. The clinician must acknowledge that these are separable phenomena in many patients and act accordingly. In many cases, suffering can be relieved, even though the physical pain that provokes it remains incurable. It is essential for both patient and physician to understand that the treatment of chronic pain extends beyond the limits of biological medicine. This book contains portraits of human pain and suffering, portraits I have created that are based on real-life experience. It is both a treatise on clinical pain syndromes and an exploration of how those syndromes alter the lives of their victims. It is an anthology of pain patients, the view of clinical hell as seen through the eyes of the damned, but with a crucial difference from real hell. Many of the people I depict here found a way out. Philosopher Bertrand Russell condemns religions that believe in hell, labeling them ferocious for even thinking there could be torment without end. He was right. The idea of eternal pain must certainly be the most ferocious thing ever conceived by the human mind. And that's exactly what many chronic pain patients fear most: pain without end. Clinical suffering depends less upon the magnitude of the hurting and more upon the uncertainty over how long the hurting will last. Stepping on a nail or bruising one's shin can cause great physical discomfort, but we know these are fleeting miseries of no permanent consequence. The elderly man with an arthritic spine, on the other hand, fears that he may never feel good again in his lifetime. Although his backache may be minor compared to the pain of an acutely traumatized shin bone, its perpetuity may drive him to the brink of suicide. In this book, I will examine the nature of biological pain in its myriad manifestations. Not the transient hurts of bruised shins, paper cuts, or sprained ankles, but the deeper pains caused by childbirth, cancer, and arthritis. I will explore maladies that appear to exist only to push the envelope of our endurance. Disorders like postherpetic neuralgia, tic douloureux, diabetic neuropathy, rheumatoid arthritis, and phantom pain. These syndromes are like plants that take their roots in physical pain, but grow and flower in the psyches of the afflicted until they choke the joy of life right out of them. The real mandate of medical care is not the saving of lives, but the dispensing of comfort. We cannot expect to live forever. Not yet, anyway. However, we can hope to live lives free of suffering. That goal may be within our grasp. Fortunately, intelligence is a double-edged sword. While it enables us to perceive suffering, intelligence also gives us the tools to understand and treat the biological processes that give rise to that suffering. To win any war, one must know the enemy, and great strides have been made in this regard. Afflictions like tic douloureux, phantom pain, and migraine are no longer the enigmas they once were. Likewise, medical science is making rapid progress in the pharmacology of pain relief. More precise methods of drug delivery, from intranasal sprays for the treatment of headaches to the computerized installation of morphine directly into the nervous system for the palliation of cancer pain, are becoming commonplace in clinical practice. The search for newer pain relievers continues, the next candidate drug coming from, of all places, the skin of a frog. Technical innovations in the field of neurosurgery have revolutionized the surgical treatment of pain. Pain centers in the brain and spinal cord can be destroyed with precision lasers or using microprocessor-guided radiotherapy. Complex electrical stimulators can be inserted directly into the nervous system to mask pain pathways, and gene therapy lies just over the horizon. Not all pain research has been in the hard sciences. Interest in the mind-body aspect of suffering has exploded, and therapies aimed at the interface between physical pain and psychic suffering are being subjected to greater scrutiny. Alternative medical approaches to pain, including relaxation therapy, therapeutic touch, massage therapy, and acupuncture, have become big business. In recognition of the roles played by depression and anxiety in chronic pain, conventional psychiatric therapy is also being tried. Some of these approaches look promising. Others may prove little more than lucrative pseudoscience. Although many of the diseases I portray will seem hellish at first, most of the victims did not suffer forever. This book contains some success stories, or at least qualified success stories. Of course, not all chronic pain patients can expect success. No medical discipline, conventional or alternative, will master suffering in all patients at all times. But the odds of success are improving. Pain is not a punishment from God, but a natural process. Sometimes, as in childbirth, pain is unavoidable and must be managed directly. Other times, it occurs when our natural pain reflexes become diseased. In these cases, the underlying illnesses can often be ameliorated or cured through timely intervention. The case histories that I've created here illustrate how even people trapped in a living inferno can emerge to lead normal lives again. This book is about the biological nature of pain and our attempts to expunge it from our lives. Nearly all of us will fall victim to some form of chronic pain. By understanding the beast, we will be better equipped to grapple with it. When treating pain, knowledge is still the best weapon. Chapter 1. Head Pains and Candy Canes. I know that pain is to be fought and thrown aside, not to be accepted as part of one's soul and as a permanent scar across one's existence. John Galt in Ayn Rand's Atlas shrugged. I'd like to begin the story of pain on a personal note. I was about 12 or 13 years old when my headaches began, and I use the word headache with some reluctance. Although it's the commonly accepted word, headache is entirely too meek a term for my condition. Webster's dictionary defines an ache as a dull, persistent pain, and that's not what I was feeling in my head. What I felt was persistent, all right, but not dull. Explosive and incapacitating would be better adjectives. I never had headaches during school hours, only at home, and usually on the weekends. They would last for hours at a time, forcing me to lie in a darkened room with a trash can at my side for the inevitable vomiting, while my friends enjoyed Little League baseball or cruised our suburban roadways on their bikes. Fortunately, the headaches rarely happened more than once or twice a month, and I never considered myself ill. Of course, my parents thought otherwise. They hauled me to a pediatrician, an ENT specialist, and an ophthalmologist in search of a diagnosis. Like all concerned parents, they feared the worst, a brain tumor. But these doctors gave us no answers, good or bad. I did need glasses, as it turned out, but correcting my vision didn't change things. I was diagnosed with hay fever, too, but the prescribed antihistamines just made me dopey and did nothing to reduce the frequency or severity of the headaches. Had the year been 1998 instead of 1968, doctors would have scanned my brain immediately. Alas, CT or MRI scanners didn't exist 30 years ago, not even on paper. In those dark ages of medicine, physicians would never think to subject an otherwise healthy young boy to the pain and terror of cerebral angiography and pneumoencephalography, the only brain images obtainable in my childhood, simply because he had an occasional bad headache. I'm still alive 30 years later, and so the decision not to torture me looking for a non-existent brain tumor was a wise one, and one for which I remain eternally grateful. A family doctor offered me a rather lame diagnosis, chronic headaches. His therapeutic advice was equally vague and useless: take aspirin. I had already told him that aspirin never helped, but he shrugged and offered no additional suggestions. Like many chronic pain patients, my therapy quickly became my personal responsibility. I was left to decipher my illness and devise my own coping strategies, which I did. But it took me almost 20 years. 3 decades and a medical degree later, I now know that I suffer from migraines, a ferocious form of episodic headache that afflicts almost 1 in 5 adults to some degree. Migraine is a weird corruption of the word hemicranial, meaning half of the head. Migraines typically affect only one side of the head at a time, right or left, while other forms of headache involve both sides equally. Migraines also prefer the front of the head, including the face, in contrast to tension headaches, also called muscular headaches, which localize to the back of the head or upper neck. Headaches caused by brain tumors or hemorrhages radiate to the very top of the head or may even be perceived in the entire head. Moreover, tumor headaches are usually associated with mental aberrations, somnolence, confusion, memory lapses, abnormalities rarely seen in migraine patients. My own pain affected my eyes, forehead, nose, and nasal sinuses, usually on the right side, a distribution fairly typical of migraine. How to describe the severity of a migraine? A close friend of mine, a nephrologist practicing in Florida, teases me by saying that migraines are just routine headaches that occur in wimps. He is, needless to say, quite wrong. The severity of migraines stems from the magnitude of the pain, not from the oversensitivity of the afflicted. The best way to simulate a migraine is to drink a cold milkshake very quickly. This maneuver will induce the bizarre phenomenon known variously as ice cream headache, brain freeze, or cold head, a penetrating sensation that grips the frontal sinuses, eyes, and forehead like a vice, often causing a person to wince and pinch the bridge of the nose until the pain eases. Now, imagine having that brain freeze pain not for the usual 10 seconds, but for 3 hours. That's a migraine. When migraines reach a crescendo, sufferers must put forth a Herculean effort to do anything, even routine things like walking, talking, or keeping their eyes open. Thinking becomes virtually impossible. Using one's brain to perform complex tasks during a migraine is like trying to run on a broken leg. It just can't be done, no matter how determined the thinker or runner might be. Migraine victims wish only to slink away and retire to bed, far from everybody and everything. The pain, aided by derangements in the nervous system, also causes severe nausea and reflexive vomiting. In the 1998 Super Bowl, a star running back had to sit out a portion of the game because of a migraine. Imagine the headache that could keep a player out of that arena. All due respects to my Florida friend, but professional football players do not generally qualify as wimps. I was watching a recent professional golf tournament, and the golfer who was leading the field almost pulled out during the last round because of his migraine. He struggled through and went on to win, yet he almost traded $700,000 for a chance to go and lie down. These examples put some perspective on how bad the pain can be. The great Pittsburgh hockey player Mario Lemieux endured recurring bouts of severe back spasms during his career, the result of a degenerating disc and a post-operative spine infection. During one particularly bad episode, when he couldn't bend over to tie his shoes, let alone play a contact sport, a young television reporter asked him why he couldn't simply play through his pain. I'll never forget the incredulous look on the All-Star Center's normally stoic face as he replied indignantly, "I just can't." I knew exactly what Lemieux was thinking. Unless you've endured the pain, you simply cannot understand. Migraine sufferers, more elegantly known as migraineurs, know Lemieux's indignation. There are some pains that even the strongest of us cannot play through. Migraines belong to a broader category of pain syndromes known as vascular headaches, which include common migraine, classic migraine, ophthalmoplegic migraine, basilar migraine, and a rare but ruthless disease that affects mostly elderly men known as cluster headache. Vascular headaches are so named because their pain emanates from arteries supplying blood to the scalp, dura, the inner lining of the skull, and brain. A vascular headache consists of two separate phases, an arterial constriction phase and an arterial dilation phase. During the constriction phase, blood vessels narrow in response to a chemical hormone called serotonin. Serotonin is in the class of compounds known as neurotransmitters. Also in this category of substances are dopamine, the neurotransmitter involved in schizophrenia and Parkinson's disease, and epinephrine, more commonly called adrenaline. Serotonin is secreted after the susceptible person is exposed to a headache trigger that may be contained in certain foods, especially red wine, cheeses, and bean products. Other headache triggers include caffeine, monosodium glutamate, allergens, pollen dust mites, hormonal changes, head trauma, psychic stresses, severe exertion, and prolonged sleeplessness. During the arterial constriction phase, narrowing of the arteries restricts blood flow to the scalp and brain. This phase is painless, although the sluggish blood flow to the brain may cause the migraineur to feel odd sensations known as migrainous auras. Auras can take many forms: feelings of anxiety, dizziness, out-of-body experiences, distorted spatial perception. Simple visual hallucinations are most common. On the very rarest of occasions, reduced blood flow during a migraine can even lead to a stroke. After the arterial constriction ends, a second phase occurs wherein arteries suddenly dilate and become engorged with blood. This dilation may be the brain's attempt to overcompensate for the reduced blood flow that occurred during the arterial constriction phase, akin to a starving man ordering up an 8-course meal. A migraineur feels headache pain during the dilation phase as sensitive arterial walls stretch to twice their normal size. The arteries derive their nerve supply from the upper branches of the trigeminal nerve, the nerve that supplies sensation to the forehead and eyes. This wiring transmits the pain of arterial stretching predominantly to the eyes and upper face. Migraines are first cousins to another debilitating condition to be discussed later: trigeminal neuralgia, or tic douloureux. Migraines and tic are both cephalgias, mediated by the trigeminal nerve. Because migraine pain originates in the arteries, the pain can be worsened by turning the head, which stretches the aching arterial walls further. The pain also fluctuates in frequency and severity with the beating of the heart. A rapid, bounding pulse will make the pain of migraines worse, something I can confirm from personal experience. Anything that increases the robustness and rate of the heart's rhythm will accentuate the pain. That's why I, like other migraineurs, try to keep as quiet and motionless as possible during an attack. Years ago, when forced to run to a toilet because of acute nausea, my heart rate jumped so high that I thought the arterial pounding would blow off the top of my head. I've tried not to repeat that mistake. The dilation phase persists for several hours, although a few misfortunates have headaches lasting several days. After the acute pain subsides, the victim is often left with a dull but tolerable throbbing in the head and a feeling of complete exhaustion. Not every migraineur has an aura during the constriction phase. Among headache syndromes, however, aura is unique to migraines. Because of the aura, migraines have become something of a romantic affliction, almost epidemic in the artistically inclined, like tuberculosis was a century ago. The auras of famous migraineurs have become the stuff of legend. The macabre world of Alice in Wonderland sprang from the spatial distortions experienced by Lewis Carroll during his auras. The oil paintings of de Chirico likewise show the influence of his migraineous hallucinations. Nietzsche was nearly driven mad by headaches, although his tertiary syphilis didn't help matters, and who knows what insights the philosopher gained from his auras. Some authors, including neurologist Oliver Sacks, have even suggested that some famous religious visions may have been auras as well. The romantic association between migraines and intellectuals at one time had some basis in science. Migraines were once thought to be more common in the mentally gifted, a belief supported by limited epidemiological evidence. This idea has been refuted by more recent studies showing no relationship between migraines and intelligence. Times change, and auras are no longer the artistic fad they once were. Altered mental states induced by illicit drugs can do the same job as auras for people looking to draw their inspiration from deranged brain chemistry. Although, I doubt that Alice in Wonderland would have had the same quaint charm had it been conceived on LSD. It's just as well that migraines are no longer romanticized. I never found my headaches particularly inspiring. To a migraineur, headaches aren't the engines of Dicurico oils, carol fables, or beatific visions of the Virgin Mary. They are instruments of torment, nothing more or less. Their supposed artistic impact aside, auras do serve a useful role for the migraineur. They sound a warning, alerting the victim that a headache is on the way. Auras are the distant rumblings of a freight train about to crash into your head. To use an aura as a warning sign, however, the victim has to recognize that it is, in fact, an aura. This sounds silly. Can a migraineur really be unaware of an aura? In fact, yes. Recognizing auras is not always easy. The word aura is from the Latin word for gentle breeze, and that's exactly what an aura can be. Gentle. Not all auras are as dramatic as those that inspired Alice's sojourn down a rabbit hole. Most auras are subtle and easy to ignore, consisting of brief visual disturbances. Since flashing spots, afterimages, and floaters can affect anybody's vision from time to time, particularly now that half-hour waking hours are spent welded to video games and computer monitors, the average migraineur may not recognize the hallucinations as a sign of imminent headache. In my own case, years of headaches came and went before I realized that I was having auras. My own aura takes the form of a tiny iridescent candy cane, twirling slowly in the extreme lower right of my peripheral vision. The candy cane becomes visible only if I stare at an empty wall or blank sheet of paper. I can't look at it directly since it immediately shifts away like a mischievous imp dancing at the limits of my vision. I've also lost large sections of my vision for an hour or more during an aura. While this sounds frightening, those of us with a long history of classic migraines learn to expect such nuisances from time to time. Recognizing my own unique aura was one step toward conquering my headaches. This recognition took me a very long time, largely because I didn't know that such things as auras even existed. During the first decade of my migraines, I knew very little about my illness and did nothing to learn more about it. A stupid approach for anyone with a chronic disease. The fact that my headaches were relatively infrequent by most migraine standards also made it difficult for me to identify patterns in their behavior. I still recall the day I realized that my body was alerting me to a looming migraine. I was in college. While reclining on my bed after a grueling organic chemistry test, I began staring mindlessly at the white plaster ceiling above. This was during my childless days, when lying motionless on a bed in the middle of the day was actually possible. I remember seeing a little candy cane, bright as a neon beer sign in a tavern window. It was a radiant rod of spinning, twinkling light made of pink and white stripes and rotating on its axis about once a second. What an interesting hallucination, I thought, but what the hell is it? Having survived the 60s and 70s without so much as smoking a cigarette, I wondered if this is the sort of vision that drugs can induce. I watched it for a while, then called a friend and made plans to go eat at a fast food place. I never made it. The rest of my day was spent sick in bed with a terrible headache. That event was an epiphany for me. Ignorant as I was of brain matters at that time in my life, I knew that there had to be some connection between the bizarre illusion and the headache. My brain was waving this candy cane at me like a semaphore flag signaling of danger ahead. The possibility that the candy cane was a migrainous omen had crossed my mind even before the headache began. Previous experience taught me that my migraines often happened after a stressful event, like my organic chemistry test. I was expecting a headache even before the candy cane appeared. By the time I finished college, I had an excellent notion of what would bring on a severe headache and the various forms my auras would take. Unfortunately, I still hadn't figured out how to stop the migraines entirely. The aura was still useful, for whenever I saw the candy cane, I knew I had to cancel my immediate plans and hide out in my bedroom. I experimented with what methods I had available before finally finding the solution with a simple over-the-counter medication. Seeking professional help never occurred to me, strangely enough, a big mistake for today's migraineur. Early in the course of my disease, I learned that if I fell asleep just after a headache arrived, I could stop it. Sometimes I needed to sleep for only 5 or 10 minutes to get rid of the pain. It wasn't foolproof. Sometimes I often awoke with a headache, but it worked well enough that sleep became my first line of defense. Sometimes sleeping just wasn't possible. For example, if I got an aura while driving. Although I did pull off an interstate once to fall asleep sitting up in my car. Most of the time, unfortunately, I just couldn't sleep because the headache was just too intense. Once the headache began, I was stuck in a catch-22 situation. I couldn't relieve the headache without falling asleep, and I couldn't fall asleep as long as the headache was there. Victims of any chronic pain syndrome know that lying down to sleep can be the hardest time of the day. To fall asleep, one needs to free the mind of distractions. But for chronic pain patients, distractions may be the only thing that keeps the pain at bay. As we try to sleep, we end up giving pain our full, undivided attention, and the pain usually makes the most of it. Unaware that there were good drugs for stopping migraines, I tried bizarre and dangerous things to get enough temporary relief to fall asleep. I even tried taking 25 aspirin tablets at once, an overdose, but I didn't know that then. Two pills never worked, so why not try half a bottle? I learned firsthand the horrors of syncinism, a temporary affliction named for the bark of the cinchona tree, the natural source of aspirin. The hallmark of syncinism is tinnitus, an unbearable high-pitched whine in the ears caused by chemical irritation of the auditory nerves. The tinnitus lasted for hours, and I thought I would go mad. The experience made me swear off pills for years, which was also a mistake. One day, I made a very utilitarian, albeit somewhat disgusting observation. If I vomited, my headache pain abated briefly, sometimes for almost 10 blissful minutes. Based on this serendipitous observation, I soon developed a ritual of vomiting, followed by hurriedly lying down and trying to fall asleep. If I didn't fall asleep within this eye of the migrainous hurricane, my headache returned, making it impossible to sleep. I would be forced to repeat the process. It would often take 5 or more such cycles of vomiting and resting before I managed to doze off. More often than not, I wound up asleep next to some toilet, stiff and sore, but headache-free. This trick worked well for migraines that made me nauseated, but sometimes I didn't feel nauseated. What then? I quickly developed ways of making myself vomit with or without nausea. During my college years, when my headaches came as often as once or twice a week, I developed a freakish ability to throw up without any provocation and on a moment's notice. In Angela's Ashes, Pulitzer Prize-winning author Frank McCourt describes with awe a man from his destitute Irish neighborhood who could imbibe ale for hours and then heave it back up without so much as putting a finger down his throat. This man was a hero to the local pub crawlers. I think I would have been a god in McCourt's neighborhood. After I finished medical school, I met a hairdresser who also used self-induced vomiting to treat her migraines. She had to stop the practice after a bad bout of retching detached one of her retinas and blinded her in the right eye. This frightened me, needless to say, but I didn't know what else to do. By then, I had relied on vomiting for years. It worked very well, and I knew of no other way to abort the pain so quickly. It was still nice to meet a kindred spirit. Nice to know that I wasn't the only one driven to using extreme pain control measures. Although research continues to unravel how vascular headaches occur, we still have little insight into why they occur. There must be some biological reason for these headaches, given their ubiquitous nature. Unlike pain syndrome stemming from the aging process, for example, trigeminal neuralgia and osteoarthritis, migraines usually begin at or before the age of puberty. Moreover, vascular headaches have a strong genetic component. Most migraineurs have an immediate family member who also suffers from the disease. Common genetic diseases that onset prior to the peak childbearing years usually provide some selective survival advantage from an evolutionary standpoint. Otherwise, they would not be propagated from generation to generation. And we know vascular headaches are not a recent affliction. The first descriptions of the disease date back 5,000 years. The Peruvian trephanations, ancient South American skulls bearing healed surgical openings, may represent early attempts to treat chronic headaches by letting evil spirits escape from the brain. Anatomically, the nerve centers that give rise to headaches are situated deep within the most ancient parts of the brain, the hypothalamus and brainstem, evidence that headaches have been around for a very long time, perhaps since the evolution of the head itself. Thus, we can conclude that migraines represent an ancient phenomenon, genetically imprinted into the brain's core wiring for thousands, maybe even millions of years. But for what purpose? After all, migraineurs should be at a selective disadvantage for survival compared to non-migraineurs, a fact that runs contrary to the grain of evolution. While evolutionary pressures don't matter for degenerative illnesses that limit the survival of the elderly, they would certainly come to bear on a common debilitating condition affecting the very young. Lying helpless with a devastating headache for many hours couldn't have been a safe behavior for primitive humans. Migraineurs would have been more prone to being devoured by wild beasts or spurned by their societies as non-productive malingerers, which happens even today, or even executed as hopelessly demon-possessed. As mysterious as evolution can be, however, it isn't stupid. Migraines must serve some beneficial function that compensates for their transient periods of dangerous incapacity, else the genetic predisposition for headaches would have been cleansed from our gene pool long ago. In truth, quite the opposite is occurring. Not only are headache syndromes extraordinarily common, some studies suggest that they are increasing in prevalence over time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.